Are you wondering how you can help your child with mathematics over the summer? Well, whether your child is struggling with mathematics or not, I really feel it's important that we keep up the academics throughout the summer. Not just math, reading's important as well. Don't get me wrong, I'm a firm believer in letting kids play, but some of their play activities can also be including academic things. I'm Christina Tonnevold, the recovering traditionalist, and I hope that you'll stick around as I'm going to share my top summer math activities for elementary students. Now, this got prompted because a friend of ours got a hold of me because he was looking on my website wanting to get some activities to help his daughter with math over the summer. And I really don't have anything because a lot of what I do, the majority of it, is geared towards classroom teachers, not so much for parents. But I am a mother of four young kiddos ranging in age from preschool to fourth grade. And there are a lot of mathy things that I do with them that I would love to be able to share with other parents. Now, let me start off before I dig into my top activities. I really want you to understand my general philosophy. I do not believe that kids need to be working on specific math content throughout the summer, like giving a bunch of worksheets during the summer and having them work on those. That is not my philosophy in the general classroom, and so I would not recommend that for you to do over the summer with your students. Now, however, if your child's teacher has said they are needing extra work in a specific area, then yes, then you can focus on that content area. But I also still don't believe it needs to be worksheet based. My whole philosophy, what I'm going to be sharing with you, is providing your child mathematical experiences, showing them math in their lives, not just sitting down and doing math on a worksheet. That makes it, number one, not fun, and it doesn't really apply to them. They're already maybe not wanting to do math, and then when we just do it in a not very fun way, they're not going to want to continue doing it. So let's make it fun, okay? So here's my top four summer activities that you can be doing for mathematics. Number one is puzzles. Yes, puzzles. I don't care how old you are, puzzles are wonderful at building your mathematical mind. There is a lot of research that shows links between our ability to spatially reason and the manipulating shapes and the link to how we perform in mathematics. So getting your child involved with lots of puzzles, having to figure out what shape goes where, some critical thinking skills about where do you start first in a puzzle, what makes sense, what do you notice that's the same, what do you notice that's different about the puzzle pieces, all of that will build their mind that helps them in their mathematical world as well. Number two is just playing games. If you have seen any of my videos, I probably mention this all the time. I come from a game playing family and I love playing games with my own kids. So whether it is dominoes or dice game like playing Yahtzee, or if you're just playing card games, right? Regular card games are great, but I also have a template for what I call the savvy subitizing cards. And even older kids love these cards because it's not just the number one, but it shows six different visual pictures of what one looks like and what two looks like. So when you're playing the normal like Go Fish or any games that you play with a deck of cards, doing it with savvy subitizing cards just adds an extra layer that even for your older kids creates a different twist. And even for us adults, it's fun to play with those cards. So card games, dice games, dominoes, just play games with the kids. Even board games. One of my favorite board games that also builds spatial reasoning is called Block Us. And I'll link to it below this video, but it's BLOKUS. It's not a C in there, but Block Us is one of the best ones to build spatial reasoning for kids. It's an amazing game. I really love it. My third one is a little bit focused on specific mathematical content. Because the number one thing that we tend to see outwardly that makes us worried about whether or not our kid is doing well in math is their ability to know their math facts. So I want to encourage you that if you're wondering, you know, does my kid know their facts? It's not just about being able to really quickly tell you what 3 + 4 is or 3 × 4, right? I do want my kids, my own personal kids, I want them fast with their facts. But I want to encourage you to do some purposeful practice with your child if you feel like they're struggling with their math facts. So basically, you know, here's a little image of your standards. Now, I shouldn't say your standards because each state has different standards. Each country has different standards. So this is one example. Your specific state might look a little different. But as you can see, kindergarten through second grade, the emphasis is on building their understanding and fluency with addition and subtraction up to about 20, right? You can see ones where they're just up to 18, but the real emphasis by the end of second grade is to be able to add or subtract anything that's 0 through 10 plus or minus 0 through 10, right? That whole idea there. So, but as you can see, each grade level, it's not like just second grade, all of it happens. Each grade level, like if you've got a kindergartner and they don't know what 7 + 8 is, that's okay. That's not their level of understanding right now. So I want to show you a little chart though too. So use that idea here for addition facts. But then this chart is showing the addition facts colored because there are certain types of facts that students gravitate towards. So it's not like you need to have your kid work on your plus ones and your plus twos and your plus threes. Have them work on these types of facts. And it's not like you need to share this chart with your child. This is a chart for adults to understand which ones kids gravitate towards and then how we can use those to help them with the ones that they aren't understanding right now. So let's say that my son, I'm working with him and I ask, you know, what's 3 + 4? And he ends up counting on his fingers to do 3 + 4. Well, then I might look at this chart and look at 3 + 4 and I notice that it's connected. It's the same coloring scheme here. 3 + 4 is a light orange, whereas 3 + 3 is a dark orange. That dark orange, 3 + 3, is the doubles. And kids gravitate towards their doubles more than they do other facts. So if my child is struggling with 3 + 4, I first want to see, do they know 3 + 3? And then help them see the connection to 3 + 4 from that. So if you're noticing that your kid is struggling, try to figure out which ones they're struggling with and then look to see which of these is it connected to. So let's say that my child was struggling with 7 + 4 and I saw them counting on their fingers to do 7 + 4. I might say, hey, bud, do you know 7 + 3? And if he knew that one instantly, okay, so 7 + 3 is 10. How does 7 + 4 connect to 7 + 3? What do you notice that's the same? What do you notice that's different? So I'm still working on the fact of 7 + 4, but I'm helping him see connections. That's one of the coolest part about mathematics is that everything is connected. And too often, your child might see mathematics as isolated skills or things that they need to memorize. The more that you can help them see connections, the better off that they will be. So use this chart. You can, you know, click the image here down below in the blog post, save it to your computer and just bring it up and say, oh, my kid, you know, if my kid's struggling with one of these facts, find where it is on the chart and then look to see what one is near it that might be helpful and help them see the connections. Now, the same thing holds true for multiplication. Now, here's the weird thing. Again, depending upon your state, yours might look a little different, but our state, kids are first introduced to multiplication pretty much in third grade, and they're expected to know all of their multiplication and division facts by the end of third grade, which pretty much kids do not actually get to that point. So all of third, fourth, and fifth grade teachers are always constantly working on trying to get kids to have fact fluency. Now, here's a little side note that I didn't mention, but I talk to teachers a lot about this. Fluency does not just mean they know it instantly. Fluently means that yes, you're accurate and you are fast, but you also have flexibility. If they don't just instantly know it, do they have a way to figure it out? And too often, the way that they figure it out is by counting on their fingers, which is not an efficient strategy. So helping kids see these connections helps build their flexibility so that if they don't just instantly know it, they have a way to figure it out that doesn't take forever, like counting on their fingers. So when it comes to multiplication, I have the same colored chart here, but it's a different types of facts. So in multiplication, those purple ones are the ones that are just the properties, like anything times zero is zero. Anything times one is the number you're multiplying by. But it's not just to memorize those. We really want kids to understand, why is it that when you multiply by zero, you get nothing? Why does that happen? Right? Why is it that when we multiply by one, you always get the other number? What does it mean? Right? Then the green ones are the times two, which is basically you're doubling the amount, right? And then the reds are times 10, and then the blue is times fives. Those ones kids gravitate towards more so than any other. Kids will memorize those quickly. They'll have quicker recall of those. And then the goal is to connect those together. So if my child is struggling with times fours, I might start off with doing something with their times two. So I might say, okay, what is two groups of three? And then they'll tell me, okay, it's six. So two times three is also known as two groups of three. So they'll say it's six. Then I'll go, okay, what's four groups of three? And I'm wanting them to see the connection of how I just doubled the number of groups, so now my answer doubles. So all of this is about connections. How is times four connected to times two? They're the lighter green ones, but how are they connected? Same thing with the blue ones. The lighter blue ones are connected to the multiplying by five. If you know you're multiplying by 10 facts, that helps you know you're multiplying by nine and multiplying by eight facts. So download those charts, just click on them, and you can save that. You can download the image to your computer. Use them for your own knowledge to be thinking about ways to build connections for your child as they're trying to work on their facts over the summer. Because that is one of the biggest pieces that causes kids to struggle. Because if they aren't quick with their facts, a lot of times that impacts the other mathematics that they're doing in the classroom. All right, now my last one that I want to share with you is have your child create a store. I swear every summer my kids do some kind of a store. So whether it's creating a lemonade stand out in front of your house and having them sell a cup of lemonade for 25 cents, even though it may cost more than that to make it, but the idea is that they get that idea of getting 25 cents and talking about how much that is. And when they have to count up their money once they've at the end of the day to see how much they made, all of the mathematics that goes into that and giving change back. So let's say they're selling it for a quarter, but somebody gives them a dollar. That idea of having to do the exchange and give change back is huge, right? I've even had my kids have done the local farmers market. Here's an image of them quite a few years ago. They look so young here, but it was back when those rubber band bracelets were a big thing. And they sat around and would make those rubber band bracelets. And then every week we would take them down to the farmers market and sell those and sell water as well because it was stinking hot and everybody would want water. So water was actually like our best seller, but they got that experience of selling stuff. And if you don't feel comfortable having them sell stuff out somewhere else, last summer, my kids just created their own store in the house and took all of their toys and were selling them to each other. Like they were totally making wild amounts, like $50 for a Nerf gun arrow, right? And so we had to have those kinds of discussions about, is that even realistic? Would somebody pay that much for that? Can your brothers and sisters pay you that much? So all of those experiences, right? The big thing I want you to take away from this video is just provide experiences. help your child see mathematics in the world around them, then when they go back to school, they will start to see that need for wanting to learn math. If they see the subject is not connected to them, they don't need it, they don't see why it's important, then they won't want to learn it. If you can instill that love of math and the love of seeing how it helps them in their life, then they will be more likely to want to learn it when they get back into school. All right, well, I hope that this has helped you parents build your math mind so that you can help build the math mind of your children this summer. Have a great day.